And the chapter name is Synthetic Fibers and Plastic. This is the third chapter of this subject. Okay, before we begin, let's see what synthetic fibers are. So, you know, we all know fibers are the basic building material when it comes to things like shirt or towel or cloth or, you know, your woolen dress. Everything is made using fibers. And so a fiber can be classified into two types, which are natural fibers and synthetic fibers. So natural fibers are the ones that occur naturally. So the examples are cotton, wool, silk, all those kinds of things. And synthetic fibers are the fibers that are made man-made. They are not naturally occurring, but it requires the help of man to be made. So what are the examples of synthetic fibers? They are common examples. They are rayon, nylon, polyester and acrylic. So these are the most common synthetic fibers. Synthetic fibers are stronger than natural fibers. So what makes synthetic fiber very popular? They are very strong, and secondly, they are wrinkle free, they are durable, and they are easy to maintain. So a synthetic fiber is very strong, it is wrinkle free, it is durable, which means it is very strong, it is long lasting, and it is also easy to maintain. And then we'll see plastics. What is plastics? Plastics are non-biodegradable substances that are durable and resistant to weather conditions. So what does that mean? So plastic is non-biodegradable, which means it cannot decay. So if you were to leave plastic somewhere and you were to come back after 100 years, the plastic will still remain intact. Nothing would have happened to it. So it is non-biodegradable. It cannot decay. And it's also durable, which means it is very long lasting. It is resistant to weather condition. It cannot corrode or it cannot rust. And although these makes plastic a very good, you know, option, but it has lots of disadvantages what should we do? We should reduce the number of plastics as much as possible. Now what we'll see in this chapter, let's see, we'll see what synthetic fibers are, we'll understand the properties and the uses of various synthetic fibers, we'll see what are polymers and how plastic is a polymer, and we'll see what are the advantages and disadvantages of plastics, and then we'll find some methods to reduce the plastic pollution or the pollution that happens because of excess of plastic. Okay, so let's see what synthetic fiber is for. So we have seen fibers can be of two types. It can be natural or synthetic. So in this previous classes, we have already seen what natural fibers are. So in this class or in this chapter, we'll see what synthetic fibers and what are their examples and how are they made, which are the most common ones, all those kinds of things we'll see in this chapter. So what are the different kinds of synthetic fibers? We have seen rayon, nylon, polyester and acrylics. These are the common ones that are used as synthetic fibers. So before we get into what different kinds of synthetic fibers are, we have to know what monomers and polymers are. So what are monomers? So synthetic fibers are made of small units called as monomers. So all synthetic fibers are made using small units. They are called as monomers. So for example, a multicellular organism like us humans, they are made using what? Units of cells. So the cell acts as a building block. In the case of polymer, monomers does the same thing. They act as a unit, and when a lot of monomers join together, they form a large unit called as polymer. So thousands of monomers join together to form a large unit called polymer. So if there are thousands of monomers joined together, then they form a one single unit, which is called as polymer. So where does polymer word come from? It comes from poly, which means many, and meros means unit. So let's see the first picture here, polymer. So a polymer is made of multiple monomers. So in the first picture, we can see a monomer there. When five of them are joined, we get a polymer. Or see the second picture, the different colored Legos or cubes are monomers. And once they are joined, they form a single unit, which then is called as polymer. So monomers can be joined into two ways. It can be joined as a linear polymer, or it can be joined as a cross-linked polymer. So when a monomer is joined in a long chain, like the first picture, if it's joined in a long chain without any cross-linkings or without any branches or without any separate paths, it is just straight, then it is called as linear polymer. But if a polymer has branches, it has different links, it can follow different paths, then it is called as cross-linked polymer. You can see the picture here. The first picture is of a linear polymer and the second picture is of a cross-linked polymer. Now polymer can be synthetic or natural. So it is not always necessary that a polymer is always synthetic. Polymer can be synthetic as well as natural. So the natural fibers like wool, cotton and silk, they are also come under polymers. But The basic difference is this, that synthetic polymers are made in laboratories or factories, but natural polymers are made at nature, made by the nature. So the process of joining together of monomers to form a polymer is called polymerization. So the process of joining multiple monomers to form a single polymer is called as polymerization. That whole process is called as polymerization. Now we'll see what makes polymers useful. Okay, why are they used? Okay, let's see what are the properties that make them very useful. The polymers do not corrode or rust. So polymers, they are weather resistant. They do not corrode or rust. They can be produced in various colors. You can easily mix colors with polymers to obtain new colors. They can be given different shapes. The polymers can be shaped the way we want. If you want a cubical shape, if you want a spherical shape, all those things can be achieved. And a polymer is very strong. So polymers are very strong material and they are inexpensive. So polymers are also very cheap. All these are the properties that make it useful, but there are certain properties that are very bad also. What are they? They are non-biodegradable, which means we have already seen, which means it cannot decay. It will remain as long as possible, and they can easily catch fire and produce poisonous gases and fumes. So when a polymer is burned, it produces a lot of poisonous gases, which is very harmful for our environment and also for all the living beings inside it. So now we'll see the first polymer, that is the rayon. We'll see the first polymer, which is called as rayon. So rayon is a synthetic fiber. So it is an example of a synthetic fiber. It is obtained from a naturally occurring polymer called cellulose, which is extracted from wood. So the rayon, the basic building material of a rayon is called cellulose, which comes from wood. So now we'll say that why is it not called natural fiber, since its basic material is cellulose, which is a natural substance. The answer to that is that after cellulose is taken, it has to go through a lot of chemical processes, chemical treatments. Only then it gets converted to rayon. That's why it is called as synthetic fiber. So if someone were to ask, even though the base material of rayon is cellulose, why is it still called synthetic fiber? The answer to that is that when the cellulose is taken from the wood, it has to go through a lot of chemical treatments. Only then it gets converted to rayon. So that's why it is called as synthetic fiber. Now, rayon was first produced in France in 1880. That is not frame, that is France. So rayon was produced in France in the year of 1880. And it is also called as artificial silk because it kind of looks like silk. And it was also the first synthetic fiber. So rayon was the first synthetic fiber to be ever produced, first man-made fiber to be ever produced. Okay, now let's see what are the properties of rayon that makes it very popular, or what makes it useful. So rayon drapes well. What does that mean? It means clothes made out of rayon can be easily folded. Like most clothes, rayon can also be easily folded. It is a good absorbent. So it acts as a very good absorbent, which means it can absorb moisture very easily. It does not shrink. So the size of the cloth made out of rayon does not shrink over time. There are certain clothes that you over certain time, the size of the fabric starts shrinking. But in the case of rayon, that does not happen. And it can be easily dyed in various colors. So the color of the rayon can be changed according to your need. It is cool to wear. It is very cool to wear. It can be worn during the summer season. And it also has silk-like appearance. So that's why it is also called as what? Artificial silk. Now let's see what are the advantages and uses of rayon. So rayon is cheaper to produce compared to other natural fibers. So compared to natural fibers like cotton, wool, to produce rayon, it is very cheap. Hence, it is a very cheap alternative to all those natural fibers. It can be easily be mixed with other fibers like cotton or wool. So rayon can be easily mixed with cotton or wool to produce a new different kind of cloth, that is a blend between cotton and rayon, or wool and rayon. And where is rayon used? It is used in textile industry. It is mostly used in textile industry in making clothes. And it is used in making carpets and bed sheets. So all those carpets that you use, you can find certain amount of rayon in it. It is also used in making bandages. Now let's see the second type of synthetic fiber, that is nylon. So nylon was the world's first fully synthetic fiber. So we had seen rayon. It was not fully synthetic fiber. Why? Because its base material was cellulose, which is not synthetic. It is natural. So nylon was the first fiber that was completely man-made, or it was fully synthetic fiber. It was developed by a US scientist called as Wallace S. Carothers and his friend and his partners in the year of 1930, somewhere around the 1930s, this nylon was developed. What was it produced from? It was produced from coal, air, water, and agricultural waste or agricultural byproducts. So these are some examples of clothes or things made out of nylon. You can see waterproof clothing, you can find gears or pulleys, bags, ropes, in a sleeping bag, and all those things. These are all these things are made using nylon. Now let's see what are the properties of nylon that makes it very useful. It is very strong. It is shiny and elastic. It is very easy to wash. It is lightweight. It can be easily dyed in various colors. It can be colored into any number of ways you want. It absorbs less water and dries quickly. It retains its shape, and it is also very long lasting fabric. And it is not over. Nylon has a lot of properties that make it very useful. Now let's see where is nylon used. In clothes such as track suits, socks, swimwear, raincoat, stockings, all these the places that require material that can does not absorb water, those places nylon is used, because nylon does not absorb water very easily. So in those places nylon is used. It is used in making curtains and bed sheets. It's used in making ropes, parachutes, fishing nets, toothbrushes, tires. All these places we use nylon. Now next come the third type of synthetic material, that is polyester. So this is one of the most commonly used synthetic fiber. So polyester is one of the most commonly used synthetic fiber, and it is made out of a long chain of polymer substance called as ester. So polyester is made of a long polymer substance called as ester, and one of the most common form of polyester is PET. Okay, so all the water bottles that you buy these days, it is very strong, they don't break easily. All those water bottles are made using a polyester called as PET. You can see different clothes that are made using polyester. So where is polyester used? It is used in textile industry to make shirts, dresses, track suits, bed sheets, etc. So it is made mostly used in textile industry, and it can also be blended with cotton and wool to obtain what? Polycotton, polywool, and terricot. So you can see the picture. It is used in bags, it is used in making caps, pillows, all those places polyester is used. Now comes the fourth type, that is acrylic. So acrylic is the fourth type of synthetic fiber that we'll see in this chapter. So it is also a synthetic fiber, but has a wool-like feel. So it is mostly close to, it has a wool-like appearance. So it is used as cheap alternative to wool. So it is sometimes used as a cheap alternative. If you wanted to buy warm clothes, which is cheap, you can always go for acrylic wool, which is comparatively very cheap compared to natural wool. So these are different clothes that are made using acrylic. Now let's see what are the properties of acrylic that make it very useful. It is warm. So acrylic is very warm, so it can be worn during the winter season. It is soft and lightweight. It is easy to wash. It dries quickly. It is easy to dye in various colors. It does not shrink or stretch. It does not change its shape or size. It is resistant to chemical and moth. Okay. Now let's see where are they used. They are used for making sweaters, shawls, socks, sportswear, etc. And they are also used for making blankets and rugs. Now this is your activity. So do it when you are in home. So find why is synthetic fiber used more commonly than natural. So you have to tell why synthetic fiber is used more commonly than natural fiber. What is the reason behind it? And you also have to find what properties of synthetic fiber makes it better option. So why? What are the properties of synthetic fibers that makes it a better option compared to natural fibers? You have to find the answers to that. Now let's see plastics. So now fibers are over. Now come, let's see what is plastic. So it is one of the most commonly used material around us. If you see around yourself, almost a lot of things are there. A lot of things you can find that are made using plastic. Your toothbrush, your comb, your bottle, your box, your mobile phone, your laptop, your chairs, all those things are made using plastic. So now the question comes, why are all these things made using plastic? Why not use any different kind of material? Why plastic is so popular? So answer to that is, plastic has a lot of properties, good properties, that make it very useful or very cheap or very common. Let's see what are the plastics are durable, which means plastics are long lasting. So plastic can last for a long time without breaking. So if you bought a, you might have seen, if you bought a plastic bottle, it usually does not ever, it doesn't ever break. It can go on for a long time without breaking. Hence it is very useful. So you can see your mugs, containers, all those things are made using plastics because it does not break easily. And plastics are resistant to weather conditions. So plastic does not get rust. plastic does not get corroded, so weather conditions does not affect the quality of plastics. Plastics are recycled, which means plastics can be used again and again. After they are melted, they can be used again and again, so which makes it recyclable. And plastic can be shaped easily. So if you wanted particular, a plastic can be shaped, which means if you want the particular shape, plastic can be easily deformed into that particular shape. If you want a square shape of plastic or cuboid, cubic shape of a plastic or material, a plastic can be easily molded into a cubic shape. And they can be reused again and again. A plastic material can be reused again and again without losing its property. And they are inexpensive and quite strong. And plastic is also very cheap, and at the same time it is very strong. So all these properties make plastic very popular, and hence all around your house you can find a lot of things made, almost 80 to 90% of things made of plastic. So these are the things you can see, they made using plastic. You can see a lot of toys, containers, chairs, and all these small containers, all these things are made using plastic. So there are two different types of, there are actually many different kinds of plastic, but in general there are two, that is thermoplastics and thermosetting plastics. So let's see what is thermoplastics first. So these are the kind of plastics that get softened when heated. So what are these? What is its main property? So if you heat a thermoplastics, what happens? It will get soft. So if you heat a thermoplastic, it will get soft. And then what you can do, you can easily bend it. Once it is soft, you can easily bend it, you can remold it, you can convert it to any shape you want. So thermoplastics are plastic that can be easily molded or blended and bend. All those things can be done after it is heated. So after it is heated, it gets becomes soft, and then you can easily bend it, you can easily remold it in any shape as you want. So PVC is an example of thermoplastic. What is PVC? You might have seen wire. All the wire that is electrical wire that go around your house. So you have seen inside is metallic, and outside you have that plastic thing. That plastic thing is called as PVC. So it is a very wise PVC use, because it's a very good insulator, and hence it can be used as a covering on the top of electrical wires. It can be used as insulation tapes, and also the plastic water pipes that you see, they are also made using PVC. It can also be used in hose pipes, that is the for pumping water. Can be used, the car seats are made using thermoplastics, and also raincoats are made using thermoplastics. So these are examples. These are PVC, yeah, PVC wire, and you have different things that are made of thermoplastics. So now coming to thermosetting setting plastics, it is completely opposite of thermoplastic. Let's see how these kind of plastics do not deform on heating and instead harden. So instead of softening when heated, these kind of material, what happens to it? It instead hardens. So completely opposite effect compared to thermoplastic. So if you were to heat a thermoplastic, what will happen? It will soften when you are heating it. But in case of thermosetting plastic, once you heat it, it will harden instead. So let's see what happens then. These plastics once set cannot be reshaped even on heating. So once you have made a particular shape of thermosetting plastic, after, even if you tried reshaping it, it won't reshape again, because it has set itself. That is a property of thermosetting plastics. So what are the examples? Bakelite is an example of thermoplastic. What is bakelite? You can see, you might have seen the new switches, the new switchboard that comes in your house, that is made using a thermosetting plastic. So if you were to melt it, it cannot be reshaped, it only get hardened and hardened. So those are the examples of, and plugs, those are the examples of thermosetting plastics. You can see the picture, old telephones, they were made using thermosetting plastic. You can see the switches or the plugs, all these things are made using thermosetting plastics. So now we have seen all the good properties of plastic, why is it so popular, but plastic is also very harmful for our environment. Let's see why plastics are non-biodegradable. They do not decay and hence keep accumulating. So what happens if you were to throw plastic somewhere? If you were to throw plastic outside your house, somewhere outside, what will happen? If you come back after 100 years, 200 years, it will still be there. It will not ever decay. So what will happen? So as you keep using more plastic and you keep throwing it outside, the amount of plastic increases. So the plastics, you know, the amount of plastic increases, it starts accumulating and it will create a lot of problems, which we'll see further. Recycling is very costly. Recycling plastic is very costly. So it is not very effective, and they release poisonous gases when burned. So if you were to try to burn plastic, what happens? It will release a lot of poisonous gases, which is very harmful for our environment and also at the same time to us. Now let's see what are the effects of plastic on environment. Plastics can choke the drains and thus block the flow of sewage water, causing overflow during monsoon. So what happens? So if you're continuously throwing water, plastic, through your drainage system, what happens? This plastic will finally go and block the path. It will enter into some, you know, hole and it will block the path. What happens? So once the monsoon season starts, so once rainfall happens, the water will start overflowing because water is not able to flow through the drainage system because all this plastic is blocking it. So once it is blocking the drainage, what happens then? Then it becomes a breeding ground for mosquitoes. And mosquitoes start breeding there in these kind of places, and also which can lead to diseases like malaria and cow. So these are the kinds of problems that you get because of plastics. Animals like cow and other animals may swallow plastic, which may cause serious health problems and may also lead to death. So sometimes in these cases, you can find a lot of these kind of news in newspaper. You can see a dead whale was found somewhere, and in its stomach they found it had lot of plastic. Or some cows, they have been continuously eating plastic. When they eat grass, sometimes plastic get in their stomach. So which can also, if they eat a lot of it, what happens? It can also lead to death. Okay, so now we'll see how to reduce plastics. We have found what plastic has a lot of disadvantages, which makes it very harmful for our environment. So what we can do instead of reducing plastics, let's see how. Using alternatives such as jute, cloth or paper bags instead of using plastic bags, what we should do? We should use bags that are made of jute, cloth or paper, so, since all these three materials are degradable. So they are a very good alternative to plastic, and encouraging the reuse of plastic. So what happens when we have plastic bag? We usually use plastic bags once and then we throw it out. But instead, what should we do? You should keep reusing the plastic bag that you have. Instead of buying new plastic bag, you should keep on using whatever plastic bag that you have. And then third one is ensuring proper disposal of plastic, which means what? You should not throw plastic on the road. It should always be thrown where? It should always be thrown in dustbin. It should not be thrown in rivers. It should not be thrown in lakes. It should always be thrown where? It should be thrown in proper dustbins, so that it does not block the path of your sewage drains, or if you throw it out, maybe the animals will eat it. So instead of to prevent all those things, plastic should be disposed properly. It should be thrown in dustbins. So that is the end of your chapter, and this is the second activity that you should do in this subject. So you have to write down the differences between thermoplastics and thermosetic plastics, as many as possible. So you have to find all the differences that you can find between thermoplastics and thermosetting plastics, and you have to write it. And then you have to find some more ways in which plastic affects our environment. So I have told you two ways in which plastic affects our environment. You have to find some more ways in which how plastics affect our environment. So that is the end of your chapter.